there's such hypocrisy in this policy here that Washington is trying to still implement. Obviously, they're trying to alienate Qatar by calling it a state sponsor of terrorism, and clearly it has been. The Qataris had been supporting ISIS financially and also logistically, among other terrorist groups there, Jabhat al-Nusra, this so-called FSA, Free Syrian Army, who are capitulators from the Syrian Arab Army, the legitimate army in Syria. And there's something much deeper going on here as far as it's an energy war. Saudi Arabia's natural gas reserves are nothing compared to this minuscule country called Qatar, who by itself is the third largest producer of natural gas after the US and Russia. And of course, we all know after Qatar comes Iran. And they actually share a huge natural gas field under the Persian Gulf, which the Iranians call the South Pars Field, and the Qataris call it simply the North Field, 60% of which is under the territorial waters of Qatar, and 40% is under the territorial waters of Iran. Now, why is this so important for them? Natural gas is important because it's the transitionary fuel between dirty energy, petroleum, coal, and among others, until we fully transition into clean energy, solar, wind power, etc. So there's going to be tremendous demand for natural gas in the decades to come as we slowly wean ourselves off of petroleum and soon to be natural gas. So the reason Washington is trying to isolate Qatar is because of energy purposes. Let us also not forget that Syria itself and Lebanon have tremendous amount of natural gas falling in their territorial waters in East Mediterranean. So there's that angle of things, which was always a factor in this so-called Syrian civil war. It wasn't Syrian civil war. It wasn't civil about it. It was a war that was exported to Syria to distract Syria from its energy, obligations and goals. And they got sort of stuck in this meat grinder that was facilitated by al-Nusra, al-Qaeda, which they called moderate rebels, a complete lunacy. And of course, the butcher of them all, these ISIS Wahhabi savages. So that strategy is, Washington's strategy in isolating Qatar is about that. A big chunk of it is about energy. And of course, this was very apparent to the U.S. political power structure in Washington. And part of the reason the Secretary of State comes from the oil background, he was the CEO, let us not forget, he was the CEO of ExxonMobil, the second largest corporation in the world, after Walmart Corporation, believe it or not, but the biggest, one of the biggest oil manufacturers, was to shift back the emphasis into energy. And that's what we're seeing here. Also, Qatar found its voice and no longer wanted to be part of this, what they call the GCC, Gulf Cooperation Council. Of course, we call it the PGCC, Persian Gulf Cooperation Council. It no longer wanted to be part of these sort of confederation of vassal states that would include Bahrain and Kuwait and UAE, It didn't want to be part of that. It wanted to be independent with its own independent policy. In some ways, it wanted to ally itself a little bit closer to the Iranians. And this, of course, was the biggest threat to the Saudis because it would sort of take away the Saudi leadership from the Arab community or the Arab nations of the world. As you're seeing, some of these Arab nations are aligning themselves closely with Iran. Qatar, to some extent, is, although it's not going to be a vassal nation of any country, but Syria, clearly, Lebanon, and Iraq definitely are aligning themselves with Iran, and soon to be Yemen, if the Saudis continue to lose there, even though they're destroying the country. So this is a huge red flag for the Saudis as they are seeing the loss in their soft power in the region. And of course, the U.S. is coming in, they're trying to salvage whatever they can from this rapidly the dwindling influence of Saudi Arabia in the region. And unfortunately, our colleagues in Washington see this as a threat. They should see this as an opportunity to once and for all ally themselves with the right countries instead of the wrong countries that are suppressing their people, Saudi Arabia at the helm of it.
How could this shift in policy be explained?
I think I just explained it. But it's a short-term policy for Washington. Policy is quite aware they can turn back time. They can't turn back what the atrocities that were committed in Iraq by the U.S. forces, as well as the geosectarian atrocities that took place. We have evidence that the Israelis were fomenting a lot of this, blowing up a Shia mosque, blaming it on the Sunnis, and vice versa, in order to create a horrible geosectarian situation, perhaps a perpetual war that will go as long as some of these old wars in Europe, going back to 500, 600, 700 years ago in Europe, the War of the Roses between the French and the English that went on for 100 years. I think these corrosive elements in Washington have that in mind, in order to create some kind of a geosectarian warfare from Morocco all the way to Pakistan, even quite possibly including India, who has which has a significant Shia, you know, population. And the Iranians are quite aware of that. The Iraqis are quite aware of that. Even the Alawite Shias in Syria are aware of that. So this policy that Saudi Arabia, this Iranophobic, Shia-phobic policy that they're trying to promote and foment and get people to come on board is not a, you know, sustainable long-term policy. It simply is not. And no matter how many multi-billion dollar worth of military contracts Washington and Mr. Trump signs with the Saudis, eventually it's going to come down to a political solution which they're going to have to somehow come to realization. Iran is a nation with a 7,000-year history. I know the number 2,500 years is always quoted. It actually has a 7,000-year civilization. Literally, there are discoveries of people living with cities in current Iran, the current map of Iran, not the ancient Persia that was from Egypt all the way to India, the current map of Iran. So the Saudis thinking that they can somehow sideline the Iranians out of this is unrealistic. Iran is not going anywhere. Iran is going to exert its soft power, its influence in the region for the sake of peace and hopefully stability. And the Saudis should jump on that ship and jump on board instead of trying to only think about losing their credibility. And part of the reason they are losing the credibility is because they're not jumping on the ship of peace and stability and some kind of a perpetual peace. They seem to be on the same strategy as those who want to have a non-ending war in the Middle East. They keep doing that, they're going to escalate their commitment into something that eventually is going to fail, as it is failing.
All this comes a little more than a week after President Trump announced a new Iran strategy, refusing to certify a 2015 nuclear agreement between Tehran and world powers. What do you read into Trump's strategy on Iran?
Well, the ironic thing is that Trump's strategy is no strategy. Mr. Trump and some of these neocon elements in Washington are having a schizophrenic policy in the Middle East, especially when it comes to Iran, reneging on its nuclear agreement. Keep in mind, this was a multilateral agreement between Washington and five other nations. For Washington to do this, to isolate itself, at least up to now, the Europeans are giving all the saying all the right things in wanting to continue their economic cooperation, their upcoming economic cooperation with Iran, because the IAEA, which is the only legal entity to certify the Iranian cooperation when it comes to their nuclear obligation, has been on board. So Mr. Trump, again, is looking for reasons. It's the same old line that Mr. Netanyahu has been repeating for the past 15 years, that Iran is only a year away from having a nuclear weapon. This delusional way of thinking that is not taking anybody anywhere, except that it's going to bolster the Iranians. It's actually, this has a unifying effect for the Iranians. Based on my observation of what happened in Iran in 2009 and how the society was kind of diverging in some elements, now the society is converging. The Iranians are coming together because of Mr. Trump's insult, because of Washington's reneging, and this horrible way of wanting to not act according to their promises. This takes away, this further corrodes at Washington's soft power, the fact that Washington cannot be relied on. One administration signs a treaty, a global treaty, sanctioned through the UN Security Council. Another administration comes in and wants to completely renege on what was achieved under the previous administration. This is the tactic of Mr. Trump. He's trying to get, you know, do away with Obamacare. And I'm not defending these programs of Mr. Obama. I'm just trying, this man is coming in and trying to completely undo the, you know, his predecessor's so-called accomplishment. He wants to renegotiate NAFTA, North American Free Trade Association. He completely took the U.S. out of TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, and not to mention the Paris Climate Accord. Now, I'm not sitting here defending the content of those agreements, but the fact that a new administration is coming in and reneging on its international obligations, international treaties, is not exactly going to bolster Washington's soft power and power of persuasion at a time where it has lost all credibility.
Is it really a new strategy?
It is not a new strategy. It's the lack of a strategy is what is going on here. And everybody around the world is witnessing this. I think a lot of these sable rattling that we've been seeing from the Trump administration when it comes to North Korea or Iran, and I don't want to put Iran and North Korea in the same sentence, quite different situations, different strategies. But what we're seeing is that they want to resort to, Mr. Trump is under the illusion that he can resort to military action in every situation. It has been leaked during his campaign that during a security briefing, this Joe Scarborough of MSNBC leaked this information. The information was leaked to him, and he went on air discussing this, that within a 45-minute security briefing, Mr. Trump tried to find the legal ramification and the legal argument on how he can use a nuclear weapon three times in a 45-minute security briefing. I don't think this gentleman has his marbles all together. And it's a very, very dangerous proposition when you have, in the Middle East, you have the Israelis on board, and they're very trigger happy, and they have been supporting ISIS, and they have been trying to destabilize both Iraq and Syria. So when you have a combination of Mr. Trump's, shall we say, lack of tact and fanaticism, and also illiteracy, global diplomatic illiteracy, coupled with Mr. Netanyahu's Iranophobic way of thinking during the past, God knows how long since he's been the Israeli prime minister, then you have yourself a very, very dangerous situation, especially when the Saudis are on board. The Iranians are aware of this, the Iraqis are aware of this, the Iraqis don't want to be part of that old coalition. They saw what happened to their country when they were allying themselves with U.S. and at that time USSR and around 40 other nations, right, in order to defeat Iran, and guess what happened? All those powers, especially the U.S., betrayed the Iraqis, got rid of their leader, their dictator, president, whatever you want to call it, and it was the Iraqis felt that was the biggest betrayal. So I don't believe the Iraqis are going to go back and try to ally themselves with the Saudis and their allies, especially the countries that dictate to them from thousands of miles away.
Tillerson also made an unannounced visit to Afghanistan. He met with President Ashraf Ghani to discuss Washington's new strategy on Afghanistan. Trump unveiled the new strategy in August, promising victory. The U.S. president authorized more troops and declared that the U.S. would avoid nation building. Successive administrations have promised victory and failed to achieve that. Will the new strategy work? And what would victory look like in Afghanistan?
There will be no victory for the United States until they realize this was not a nation in the first place. Unfortunately, since the Soviet invasion in the 1980s, this society had totally come apart. Has become, it's going back to its tribal roots. Yes, there is a central government in Kabul. There is a president and what have you. But the power really emanates from these warlords, these tribal leaders, these chiefs, and this strategy of sending more troops. This is the same old mistake that Mr. Bush committed, Bush the son committed, and he called it the surge. And that didn't work out. Because you, in order to defeat an ideology, you can't just send in, you know, the military. You have to come up with another ideology that will compete with that, with this first ideology that you're trying to defeat, and that's how you go about it. And the Afghani population, they are very wary of anything that Washington is going to propose as far as an ideology. They don't want that. They want to go back to their tribal roots. Be it good or not good, I'm not sitting here, you know, assigning value to either one. The global community certainly has condemned the Afghanis under the Taliban for gross human rights violations and what have you. But, the U.S. went there in 2001, right after 9/11, was to get rid of Taliban. Why? Because Taliban was supporting Al-Qaeda, and Al-Qaeda was, of course, hosted or headed by Osama bin Laden. Now they want to go back and negotiate for the same people which they accuse of being under those horrible events in 9/11. What does this say about U.S. foreign policy, really? On one hand, you could say they're trying to have some kind of a political settlement with their enemies, the Taliban, which may not necessarily be a bad thing if people come together. But on the same token, I don't believe it's about the trying to establish peace and security. I think it's about making sure that the so-called Afghani central government doesn't become too close with the Iranians. The Saudis see this as a huge threat because they want to exert their Wahhabi influence in Saudi Arabia, their support of the Pashtuns and what have you, vis-a-vis the Pakistanis. So again, here there's no policy. They're going back to the same old neocon strategies from the mid-2000s. We all saw the failure of those policies. It's not going anywhere. So again, this shows, this fully proves, this exhibits Mr. Trump's lack of tact, lack of deep thinking, lack of a sustainable situation and a remedy to this crisis. And let me not also forget to mention that Afghanistan was the longest war in this nation's history. In the United States, we have been in war 223 years out of our 240-year existence, going back to 1776. What exactly does that tell about us? We are a war-mongering nation, unfortunately. And this conflict in Afghanistan has been the longest war we have been engaged in. Let's not forget that no empire has defeated Afghanis in this area. Every empire who has come to the mountains of Hindu Kush, starting with Alexander the Great, fast forward to the 19th centuries with the British, and then the Soviets, and now us, has failed there. So for us to not have learned from from the history when it comes to somehow overpowering a tribal people who are very brave, who have a sense of honor, and who are rigid in their methods, and who are, in my opinion, experts at guerrilla warfare, doesn't matter how many special forces team you send there, you're still in a foreign country that sees you as the enemy. So it's not going to be looking good. And that's my forecast. That's my advice to Washington to, although Mr. Trump says he doesn't want to engage in nation building, how would they define victory? How would they define it? What do you just drop these huge bombs, as they did not too many months ago? The biggest bomb they drum on the Afghanis, what exactly are they going to prove? When you go to a wedding reception, just because there's a few terrorists and you kill 150, 200 people at a wedding reception, and then you call that victory, that's only going to alienate Afghanis toward us. So there is no clear definition of what victory looks like.
Tillerson then visited Pakistan with a tough message, accusing Islamabad of providing safe havens for Taliban militants. He said Pakistan's cooperation on counterterrorism was key to a good relationship with the U.S. Pakistan is furious with U.S. drone attacks and see them as violation of its sovereignty. How do you assess the U.S.-Pakistani alliance, and what's on Tillerson's agenda?
The U.S.-Pakistani alliance is not looking so good. Of course, in the 1980s, this was a strong alliance. A lot of money and weapons were funneled through Pakistan to reach the Mujahideen in Afghanistan. They had somewhat of a close relationship. Of course, this was the theory of the former national security advisor of Jimmy Carter, who recently passed away, Zbigniew Brzezinski. At that time, it worked because the big bad enemy in Washington was the Soviet Union. Now, that's not the case so much. And unfortunately, our colleagues in Washington have not exactly learned from that mistake. The Pakistanis are furious because the U.S. has illegally invading their airspace, whether it be a funeral arrangement or a wedding arrangement in order to kill a few terrorists. They invade somebody's national airspace, not to mention the fact that they got Osama bin Laden in Pakistan, close to a Pakistani military academy, the highest actually in that nation. Tells so much about that, Pakistanis are sort of on the fence, and if not that, they clearly want to perpetuate the Taliban narrative. The Taliban go back and forth across the Pakistani-Afghanistani border. In Waziristan, you have all this for all means and purposes, it's an autonomous region. The Taliban are there, they'll go back and forth, and the U.S. is reaching a conclusion that they somehow have to include Taliban in this peace negotiation or this peace process. But ultimately, it's going to come down to how much they're going to be bribed, how much money they're going to give to Taliban to cease and desist from its activities. Of course, the Saudis are not happy with this. The Saudis would like, again, a perpetual war to continue.